Everyone, so today's session will begin with unit 2. So the first part in unit 2 is the assembly directives, ARM assembly directives. So what do we mean by ARM assembler directives? So ARM assembler directives are nothing but these are the assembler commands which are used to direct the assemblers. So the commands which are used to direct the assemblers are also known as a pseudo opcodes or also known as pseudo operations. So what are the tasks or the command this command perform? So the first task is that they assign the program to certain area in memory. So since we have a single memory, so the memory can be designated or assigned as a code memory or as a data memory. Next, we can also define the symbols. So using the assembler directives, we can also define some of the symbols. Next, we can also designate areas of memory for data storage. So the data, since it is a variable, it has a variable size. So based on the size of the data, we can allocate the memory to that data. So for example, if the data is 8-bit, we can allocate a 8-bit memory. If it is a 16-bit, we can allocate only 16-bit memory. If it is 32, we can also allocate 32-bit of memory. Next, we can also place the tables or other fixed data in the memory using this assembler directives. It also allows for references to other programs. So if you want to have a reference of other program into our current program, we can do so by using the assembler directive. And the assembler directives are executed during the assembly time. So this is the point to keep in mind, that it only executed during the assembly time, and this won't be executed during our processor runtime like other instructions. Now coming to the some of the attributes for the assembly directives, we have 4 attributes. The first is the code, data, read only and read write. So what do you mean by a code attribute? So code indicates that it contains the machine instructions, and by default these instructions are read only. Next we have data. Data is nothing but this only contains the data and not the instruction. So by default it is a read write. Since data is a variable and we need to change the data, we need to read as well as we need to write onto the data. Next attribute is read only. So the read only indicates that the whichever area we mention it as a read only, it is only the area which can be read and cannot be written onto it. Next we have a read write. So what does a read write indicate? A read write indicates this area may be read from or it can be written into. So let us go ahead with the different assembler directives. The first directive which is there is the area. As the name indicates area, it assigns the area for the program or subroutines and also for the data reside. So how exactly we are going to use this area directive? So the syntax here is, first we need to write the directive name, that is area. Then we need to give the section name. So what do you mean by a section name? Is it is the name for the area and it is a user defined. So a user can define or give any name to this section. The next, after this section name there is a comma, then we need to give the attribute. Now this attribute can be a code or it can be a data. Suppose if you are writing the instruction, we need to mention this as a code. If we are having a data, we need to mention this attribute as a data. The next attribute we need to give it as, either if you are using it as a code, we can make it as a read only. If you are using that as a data, we can make it as a read write. So these are some of the attributes which we have: code, data, read only and read write. And this is the syntax how you are going to write the area directive. Next, let us go ahead with the directives which is entry and end. So once we start writing the assembly program, the first thing we need to do is to assign the area. And how do we assign the area? Is by using the area directive. Once we have assigned the area to the program, next we need to write or give the directive as entry. So what does the entry directive do? So So entry directive gives you the entry point for the assembly language program. So from this entry directive, your execution of the program starts. So remember one thing, at least one entry point at the beginning of the program is must. If we do not mention the entry directive, there is a warning which is generated at the link time. And only one directive per source, single source file is acceptable. We cannot write more than one entry directive in a single source file. If we do so, there is an error message which is generated at the assembly time. Next is the end directive. So as we have the entry directive, which says it is the beginning of the program, we have the end directive. So the end directive indicates that it is the end of the program. So this causes the assembler to stop processing the current source file. Every assembly language source program must finish the program with this directive. So let us go ahead with an example which demonstrates the three directives, that is area, entry and end directive. So this is the example. So you can just have a look here. We have an area. So we'll just have a highlighter. So this is the area directive. So this is the directive which is area. So after area directive, we have given the section name as my code. We can give this as any name as it is a user defined. So we have mentioned it as a my code, comma, provide the attribute. Now since we are going to write the instructions in this area, we are going to make it as a code, and the code is always a read only attribute. After we have mentioned the area directive, the next we need to write as an entry. So as I already said, the entry is nothing but the entry point for any program. And once we have written the entry, the next we are going to have the user code. Okay, so after the entry, we are going to have the code here, the user code. So that is nothing but the instructions we are going to provide here. We're going to write some instructions. Once we have done with some instructions, we are going to end our program with end directive. So this informs the assembler that this is the end of the directive, that is the program. Next, directives are based on the data reservation directives. So we have three data reservations. So what do you mean by data reservation is, it is used to reserve the memory for the specific data. So we have three types. We have DCB, DCD and DCW. So what does this do is, it allows the programmer to enter the fixed data in the program memory. So DCB stands for defined constant byte, which is 8 bits. Next we have a defined constant word, which is 16 bit, which is also called as a half word, since we have ARM7 processor, which is a 32 bit, and 32 bit indicates a word. So DCW in this case is nothing but 16 bits, which we call it as a half word. Next we have a defined constant data, is which is nothing but for a 32 bit data. So the data includes, the data which we are using can include, it can be any name, it can be a message, it can be any subroutine name, address, or it can be any tables. So this is how we have the three different data memory allocation directives. DCB is for 8 bits, DCW is for 16 bits, which is a half word, and DCD is for a 32 bit data. Next. So these are some of the syntax which we have. So if we want to use a DCB directive, which is nothing but allocating a byte, that is 8 bit number. So this is the syntax which we are going to use. That is nothing but we need to provide the label, that is the name, then the DCB as the directive, and then give the expression or the number which is a 8 bit number. Similarly we have it for DCW, similarly we have it for a DCD. So DCD allocates a 32 bit number. So what does this mean is, so when I have a 8 bit number, I'll be allocating a 8 bit memory for this number. Similarly, when I use DCW, I'll be having a 16 bit number, so I'll be allocating a 16 bit memory for this 16 bit number. Similarly, for 32 bit number, we'll be allocating a 32 bit memory for that. So this is used so that we optimize our memory. Next directive which we have is the align directive. So as the name suggests, align directive is nothing but it aligns the current location within the code to a word. Word is a 4 byte boundary. So when we have allocated the memory, so if we want to have a alignment, so we always have a even alignment of the memory, which is a 4 byte boundary. So this is the syntax which we have for align. So if we see here, this is the align directive name. Then we need to mention the expression. So what do we mean by an expression here is, expression can be any power of 2 from 2 raised to 0 to 2 raised to 31. So if we see the current location is always aligned to the next 2 raised to n byte boundary. If this parameter is not specified, so if we are writing a program and if we are not mentioned any align directive, the align sets the instruction location to the next word boundary. So by default, it is a 4 byte boundary which will be aligned. So once we have given the expression, we can also give a offset expression. So what do you mean by offset expression here is, it defines a byte offset from the alignment specified by the expression. So this offset expression is given, suppose if we have mentioned the area as a code area and we have written the data into the code area. So if we see all the instructions, so code area means we are going to write the instructions, which are all the instructions are of 32 bit. So if I write any data into this code memory, even that data will be having a 32 bit memory. So in case if I have mentioned a data of 8 bit, so the memory by default which is allocated to that is a 32 bit. So if you do not want to have that, we can properly align that memory. So for that we can use the offset expression. So offset expression defines the byte offset from the alignment specified by the expression. So you can just have a look here. It is used when data definition directives like DCB, DCW, DCD are used in the code areas. The program counter does not necessarily point to a word boundary. So program counter, when we are using this DCB, DCW, DCD, not necessarily point to the word boundary. So we can use an offset expression. So it is also used to ensure that your data in the code are aligned to an appropriate boundaries. This is must, so that each and every instruction and the data has to be aligned appropriately in the memory, within the memory boundary. This is regarding the align directive. Next, coming to the directives called export and input directive. So export is nothing but if we have defined any symbol in any other program and we just want to take that symbol in our current program. So in the current program, we no need to redefine that symbol. So I can just have a reference of the previous program where the symbol is defined and I can just export that into the current program. So it is, export is basically like declaring it as a global variable where you can use it. So the syntax for the export is given here. So export and then give the symbol name. Next we have the import directive. So what does an import directive do is, so Input directive provides the assembler with a name that is not defined in the current assembly. So if we mention an import directive and then we can give, if we give a name, that means we are giving a name to the assembler which is not defined in the current program. So this is regarding the export and the import directives. For example, we can just have a look for the export directive here. So we always begin with the area directive, then give the section name. So section name here is example. Then give the attribute. So if we want to define that area as a code, we take it as a code and then we have a read only. And once we do that, suppose I want to export some symbol into my current program, I need to mention the export directive and then mention the symbol name. So in this case, it is the doAdd is a function name which I am exporting, and using this doAdd function name in the current program. Next directive is arm and thumb directive. So arm and thumb indicates that the instructions are either in a arm state or they are in the thumb state. So suppose if we begin with the program and we have started with an arm state, and in the middle of the program, if you want to change the state of the arm to a thumb state, that is a 16-bit instructions, we can do so by using the thumb directive. So in the program, if we start, first we can write it as an arm. So when under this arm directive, if I start writing the instructions, those become the arm state instruction or 32-bit instructions. And once I do that, if I want to change the state, I can just change the state. So basically, when we have the subroutines, we always go from arm state to the thumb state. So you can just have a look here. This section starts in arm state. Then we have given next. Then we have given the instruction as LDR. So you can see the next instruction which we are given is LDR R0. R0 is nothing but the register name, and in this register we have loaded the address of the start, which is nothing but the label start here, which has instruction move R1, #10. So BX is nothing but a branch instruction, which is a branch and exchange instruction, which is for the subroutine. So we have R0, where R0 is having the address. So when I say branch and exchange, it goes to the address which is stored in R0. So what is the address which has the label start? So it goes here and start executing the instructions. So once I have done that, from when there is a branch and exchange instruction, by default the arm state will be changed to the thumb state. So from here we start with our thumb instructions. So this is arm and thumb directive. If you want to have a change in the state, you can use arm and the thumb directive. The last we have we have equate directive. Now, as the name itself suggests, equate, it equates a symbol, it associates a symbolic name to a numeric constant. So if I have any number, I can associate a symbol or a name to that number. So this is how we have the equate directive. It is similar to the C program where we use hash define. So as we see in a C program, we write is hash define, then we give the name and then we assign a value to the name. So same hash define, we have a equate directive in a ARM assembly program. So the equate can be used to define a constant in a assembly code. So you can see we have the syntax here. That is nothing but we first provide the name. This is what we are doing. We are giving the name here. We are giving the name. Then we are going to write the equate directive and then mention the expression and the type. So for example, just we can have a look here. We have number is the name which we need to give, then equate is a directive, and then we have assign a value 100 to the name number. This is how an equate directive works. Okay, so next we have the space directive. So, as the name suggests, space directory, whichever is the space vacant in the memory, so those spaces will be reserved with a zeroed block of memory. The align directive must be used to align any code following a space directive. So, you can just have a look for the syntax here. So, we have the syntax. So, we need to first specify the label. So, here we need to first specify the label. That is, label is nothing but the user defined name. Then, mention the space directive and then give the expression. So, for example, you can see we have given here, start with the area directive, then give the section name, then mention it as a data memory, then attribute it as a read write, then give the label. So, data 1 and data 2 are nothing but the label. So, once you give the label data 1, then give the space, and after the space we can give the number as 255. So, this 255 is nothing but it defines 255 bytes of zeroed stored. So, 255 bytes of memory will be stored with the values as 0. Similarly, the data 2 is again a label. Then we have the value, or this is the directory called field. So, what we do is we have field 50, 0xAB, 1. So, this defines 50 bytes containing 0xAB. So, 0xAB is the value which will be stored in that memory. So, this is how a space directive, and this is how we have the field directive which we have. So, this is regarding the assembler directives what we have. So, this is the end of the session. This was the first part of unit 2, which consists of ARM assembly. Assembler directives. So, in the next session, we will be dealing with the ARM instructions. For there are different types of instructions: data processing instruction, conditional instructions. So, we'll be looking at those instructions in the next session. Thank you.